Tech in movies.
The sci-fi movie discussion group, right?
Yes.
I think we should go around and say one of our favorite classic sci-fi movies.
What do you mean by classic?
Yeah, define classic.
Okay, yeah. Just in general,
sci-fi.
Okay. What is
science?
For, you know, define technology.
I give up.
Oh man,
you're up.
That's up.
Science fantasy.
Science fantasy. No,
yeah.
don't do that.
Speculative fiction.
Well, mine's Fifth Element. So.
We can sort of tell that some little clue there. Sometimes.
I know what your handwriting looks like.
That's supposed to be.
Well, I assumed you were the person who wrote it on the poster on the old.
No, I wasn't. It's another, like.
Okay.
That's
awesome.
Yes.
Everybody loves The Fifth Element.
Yes, but can
love
they quote it verbatim?
The Fifth Element.
Well,
when
I went to go see it,
I didn't
know the whole thing.
I get this word online for it. But that's when I went in thinking I was getting a, you know, solid, you know, sci-fi action adventure movie, not.
Like Chris Tucker screen.
Not the campy thing that we got. Once I came back to it with the right mindset, I enjoyed it a lot.
It really wasn't that campy in the time that it was made, if you think about it.
I vaguely remember when it came out.
It was early.
I saw it in the theater.
Yeah, well, I missed the first part of it. My pager went off. I went up to fix the power, came back and saw this woman, and what was this all about? How did this all start? You know, so kind of lost a lot of that, you know.
Well,
the whole
the
reason was
you missed the first 5 minutes, especially like Marvel movies.
It was, yeah.
Why did it go?
I mean,
what was the
blue lady's
name?
Gary Oliver
or something?
I don't remember.
Did we see Amazing Spider-Man
2?
Well, I thought the cool part of that was the technology with the taxis.
Yeah.
And how they were doing three-dimensional travel through the cities and all that stuff.
Yeah.
That was the cool part.
I like when they printed Bebo's new
book.
Yeah. That was like
in the right place.
That was like major Hollywood movie with 3D printing before 3D printing. Yeah.
Right, yeah.
I know about Rapid Prototype at the time, and I watched that scene and went, oh,
yes. Do you think that was intentional from the filmmaker?
I'm an optimist, so I would like to think that it was intentional because it seemed really poignant and awesome to me. So.
For me, it's a toss-up between Pacific Rim from Forbidden Planet.
Oof.
But I'm a robot geek.
Pacific Rim was awesome.
I'm not familiar with Forbidden Planet.
Wow.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Go to the Kmart bin where they have the $1 movies.
Excellent.
Sorry, Leslie Nielsen.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Yeah.
1950.
What a serious role. The original.
Was it the same robot? It was the original robot.
He got. That particular prop got recycled through so many TV shows and movies. I grew up on a diet of Rocket the Robot. It was.
Now, where did he get the name
awesome.
Rocket? Was that from his original appearance?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, so he was Robbie in Forbidden Planet.
Lost in Space. I thought he was just the robot.
No. The robot from Lost in Space is just the robot.
Right.
Robbie appeared
Robbie
in Lost in Space, but was
no,
not
it's
Robbie.
Different. It's a different.
Yeah, the Lost in Space robot is a different robot.
Rocket's got arms and legs, looks almost like a diving suit with a big knobby. Lost in Space robot has accordion hose arms, no legs, rover on a treads. But you can tell there's a definite thematic homage or theft going on there.
They're so close.
Yeah, I would go with
they're cousins.
That's the same. Love the old stuff. The original Avios was still.
Oh, yeah.
Creature from the Black Lagoon.
Well, that's just
we're talking about
Avios.
Avios is still the original.
Oh,
story.
Yeah.
Do you want Aliens to sign by? So
is
Creature from the Black Lagoon.
What's the origin story for Creature of the Black Lagoon? What caused him to form in the Black Lagoon? I'm not familiar with the plot.
He was from it.
He
is this Skirmish from the Southern?
Camera's blocking, I can't see her.
That's sci-fi.
They go in, they get trapped in the lagoon, he's in there going, oh, get out of my hole. You're not gonna get out of my hole, I blocked off the edge and I'm gonna kill you all.
But if you follow Alien to Prometheus timeline, then it did definitely. See, that's the only one I can see is Prometheus.
Yeah.
That's actually going back.
Okay.
They're coming out with another one, I guess.
Yeah, thank God.
I liked Prometheus, but I also didn't like Prometheus.
Yes.
Yeah.
If it had not tried to be attached to Alien, I think it would have been well enough.
I didn't like Resurrection.
I enjoyed the experience watching it, but there are many things that are like, oh man, this really tall thing is coming at you, and you're going to continue running in a straight line away from it.
I love that. Yeah, everyone's
three. Little things like that really ruin.
How about the big things, like everything you could do with this elite team of scientists, everything you can do to get a contamination on your ship, you did. Let's breathe the atmosphere. Let's drink everything. This guy who disappeared in the ruins has now shown up in this pretzel. We didn't see him approach a ship. Now he's just sitting in a human, horribly contorted pretzel. Why aren't we suddenly flamethrowing the crap out of him? Why are we opening the ship? We have cameras out there. You can see he's horrible.
It's game over, man. It's game over.
The entire movie was
full
of stupidity.
I think we
messed up
and give the victim to Corbin. It's the only way to be sure.
There's an awful lot of fantastic sci-fi stuff out there. Some of the recent stuff's actually been rather good. But if I have to pick a favorite, at the end of the day, I was born in the 80s, grew up in the country, and played a lot of video games, so I can't pick anything but Last Starfighter.
That's an underrated movie.
Well, to me, I think one of the key items in a story is that it's got something interesting going on, and then at the end, there's something to think about, right? So, and to me, one of the things that, a twisted end, where you're not really sure, did it really happen or didn't? So for a long while, the Schwarzenegger Total Recall,
did he actually do this, or was it
just a memory implant? And that type of thing was really a kind of cool thing. And I haven't seen it. When I did the redo, it was kind of, they lost that. Didn't take off, didn't make it.
And they didn't show the three boobs.
No. Come on, guys. Let's talk about
sci-fi, my favorite go back to is Blade Runner has been.
Oh, that's a classic. That is a good one.
I still watch it regularly.
Soundtrack for that.
Soundtrack. Yeah,
which of the seven versions do you prefer? The director's cut? The ultimate director's cut?
The ultimate super director's cut, right? Of course, on the other hand, you can't.
You know, both these last two, based on Philip K. Dick novels.
Yeah.
For the books, I recommend Ubik.
I read Do Androids Dream of Electric Sheep?
Yeah.
It was good. It was good. It was a lot stranger than Blade Runner, definitely.
Yeah.
I like the book better.
We'll see. My favorite one is also a Philip K. Dick, Cold Equations, which is.
That's the short story I'm thinking of. It wasn't Philip K. Dick.
It was. I thought it was off of one of his. It's not the same title.
No,
okay.
No, there's a short story of that title.
Famous short story.
Yeah, very.
It's
Tom. It was either.
Have you seen Ender's Game?
Oh yeah,
Ender's Game was pretty good.
The new
movie?
Yeah, the short story version I thought was better.
I mean, the book's gonna be better.
But I didn't realize Orson Scott Card was insane in those days, so.
Oh,
that scares me a little bit.
Yeah. It's a sci-fi writer, you know.
I don't think it's actually been made. It's not anything recent, but as we're talking about short stories, I would, and also about insane writers, but I would love to see Hollywood try to do something with Repent Harlequin Said the TikTok Man.
Which one was it?
Repent Harlequin Said the TikTok Man. It's one of Harlan Ellison's most famous stories.
Yeah.
And Harlan Ellison is insane and not
yes.
a good person, but it's a very interesting story. He has a very interesting sort of unique writing style. And then just punctuates it with some completely random things, like this recurring thing of, but where did he get the jelly beans?
Where did he?
I never explained.
Since they already did, people glass again.
How about a film version of The Accidental Time Machine?
Not for that one story.
That's, I'm pretty sure it's.
I know a lot of it's work.
Well, then I don't remember who it is, but anyway, it's MIT grad students working on these timing things, and one has an error. It's just timing wrong by a factor of 12. And then he realizes, wait a minute, it's not timing wrong, it's transporting itself. Every time I press it, it was nanoseconds, by a factor of 12, it's actually can see it, it disappears, and then shows back up in the same spot, like 12 minutes later. And just every time he presses this button, this thing travels through time by a factor of 12 longer. He ends up building a like Faraday cage style compartment. First it was his car, he hooks it up to the metal body of his car and sits in it, and shows up like 12 days after he started. It just keeps throwing him into the future longer and longer. At one point, people are aware, MIT is aware of what's going on, and they predict where he'll show up. It starts also having spatial drift. He shows up in a stadium where people have been waiting for him because they knew he was going to show up. He shows up hundreds of years in the future in like it's New England area after something has happened, and now it's this sort of dark ages theocracy while the rest of the world is, from what he can gather, going along fabulously. Shows up in the super far future where everything is based on auctioning. You just have the internet and it's all eBay. Everything is just eBay. That's your entire economy. And then he just goes and sort of loops around. I think that would be cool. Because throughout the entire story, it's just sort of, how did I get here? What happened? I have lost the intervening time and this is a new place. And Hollywood would ruin it, but it would be really cool.
Yeah. I just think one of those old, it's an old short novel. It could actually work well as a sort of sci-fi comedy called The Technicolor Time Machine. And, I got a copy at home. I can't remember the name.
name of the author. It was a minor work by a fairly big name from the 50s and 60s in sci-fi. And basically, this movie studio that is going out of business stumbles across a scientist who's created a time machine but can't get anybody to believe that it actually works. And the studio is like 3 days from having to put their books in front of the auditors to say, hey, we're broke. And we got nothing to sell. And this the studio's fix-it guy, this guy has found this time machine. He says, it's not a problem. We're going to take a scriptwriter, take him back to the late Cretaceous, set him up beside an electric fence, a couple of stuntmen to be bodyguards. We'll have him write a script. Then we'll Vikings. We'll do Vikings. Vikings are big this year. Then we'll jump the entire cast and crew back to where we got actual real Vikings, and we'll film the movie there. And we'll just jump back to, you know, an hour after we left, and we'll have a brand new movie in the can. We'll put it in front of the audience and say, here, brand new summer blockbuster. We're out of bankruptcy before we even get there. And much hilarity ensues. And it's all played very, very lightly, very big for fun. They end up hiring a bunch of actual Vikings to be in their movie because the Vikings discover that this is really a lot more fun and a lot less risk than dealing with Skrulls in the over in the New World, and they end up accidentally writing themselves into one of the great Norse Eddas. But the whole thing is just fun from end to end. There's no seriously dark bits anywhere. It was just done as a straight sci-fi comedy. I think it would really play. Probably would bark at the box office, but you know, our problem.
Sounds better than
yeah, you
play it like right. Yes,
terrible. Play it like Galaxy Quest. It would be perfect.
Yeah.
I love
that.
I love Galaxy Quest.
Yeah.
I bought worn out my DVD. I watched it so many times.
Well, so the part I liked about it was when they're taking the new ship out, and then he's like rubbing against the wall. He's like screaming.
they're craning their necks like they're gonna help the ship steer.
Yeah.
Yeah. For a minute there, you almost thought they were going to a Star Trek 1 moment. You know, coming out of the space dock. Then it's.
The space balls?
Sure.
Yes.
Yes!
Sure!
We need space balls too. Search for more money. We need space
balls. What did anyone tell me my ass was this big?
That's pretty much just Mel Brooks sitting on his retirement plan. So eventually, I'm just going to want to buy an island. So when that happens, he'll do that.
For more money.
It's good. It'll work. In terms of more recent things, has anyone else, or did anyone else here see Cloud Atlas?
Yes.
Yes.
No,
yeah.
I wanted to.
Yeah.
Explain it to me. I just, you know, it's like, okay, so everybody in, so I read it afterwards. You know, watched it. I think, what was this? I read the synopsis afterwards, and I think, oh, it's the same actors playing these parts that are somehow linked. And I couldn't get that because I couldn't recognize the actors were the same people. You know, so they did such a good job at disguising this famous actor's face, I couldn't see who it was, you know.
I couldn't know. I saw the trailer, I was like, I don't get it. What?
Isn't that the idea that, like, they've been reincarnated or lovers each different time and they're still finding each other
it's
or something
not,
like that?
It's kind of, there's one character who's presumed to be a reincarnation or some such, who has the same, there's six different stories, and the real point of it is how minor things in the life of one person have profound effects on other people further on. Like the character in the earliest story writes a journal that the next one reads, that person is, like, that person's lover is, you know, survives him and becomes a very important character to the next plot line, and so on and so forth down the line. There's one set of characters, one in each of the six stories, that all share a very similar birthmark, but they never make anything really specific of it in the movie. It's mostly just
they show up.
I haven't seen the movie, but I saw the trailer when the birthmark stream. Like I saw like the two faces. they're like reincarnating to each other. They're gonna like find each other. Like, I thought it was gonna be like a romantic, like kind of.
Was it the Holly Berry? Doesn't she plays a white woman in one of the sequences?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And they did, you know, the makeup and stuff was fabulous.
I mean, it was. Is that her? You know, I don't stare at her.
Yeah. With the freckles.
I really liked in that part, so
it
was not so much in love with, but that was pretty weird.
The costume design was great all the way through.
I've got one.
Like the Japanese rope human robot songs?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, so I saw Captain America, the Winter Soldier, right? And the movie was kind of so all right, but there was this part where they had these huge platforms, these military platforms that lifted all off.
Carriers, yeah.
And I think, okay, so this is the ultimate, like, in drones, you know? This is where we're going with drones. You're going to have this, you know, massive battleship thing that floats in the sky, and it's totally automated.
Huge flying targets.
That brings me to what you're talking about.
Battleships
in
the
sky. A guy can't fill up the Minority Report.
I like that.
I in terms of like, you know, technology and sci-fi, Minority Report is just.
Yes.
I feel like we're getting there.
Well, so there was a biff earlier today. Not, was it a presentation earlier today about cyber? Cybernetics and stuff, and there was some of this, you know, trying to connect one person to another and that type of thing. So very early beginnings of that. But yeah, I think it's pretty cool. There was what movie was it? I can't remember. It's like a Schwarzenegger or something where they did, you could download a memory and then save it, and then later on you could build
Johnny Mnemonic. Johnny Mnemonic.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
So there's, you know, some cool implications.
Running Man? Are we getting there yet?
Oof, I watched that the other day.
Running Man's a good movie.
I had to show my kids.
And then The Hunger Games is totally.
Wonder if anyone will make a movie of Robert Silverberg had a great, I don't know whether to call it a short novel or a very long short story, called Born with the Dead. Mm-hmm. That was just a fascinatingly creepy, very unforgettable story about a future time when if people die, you know, unless, of course, you know, they're mangled or something like that, they can be rekindled. And, you know, they come back to life and they seem to be, they're living persons, but they're changed in some way that everyone who is rekindled goes to live in special communities set aside for them because they're changed somehow. They're like, somebody described it as being spiritual autism. You know, that they couldn't relate to living people anymore. But anyway, a fascinating tale. Robert Silverberg.
Was it someone who wrote, or Helen Dean Foster? Foster wrote a book called Midworld.
The Flinks.
It's not in the Flinks series, although he did go to that. Did go to that planet at one point. The original Midworld. I was just wondering if anybody else thought that James Cameron stole Avatar from it, because it sure as hell looked like Avatar to me.
Well, like I said, a lot of these technologies they borrowed.
Avatar, Dances Underwater.
Yes, it was Dance.
It goes all the way back to the Roman, right. To the Centurion.
The planet, the creatures, the environment is that story.
Okay.
But without the untamed.
Correct, right. Although, actually, that's the story. People from Earth come to this planet, find resources they want, start beating up on the natives. The natives get together and beat the crap out of them.
So it's the same freaking movie.
They just don't call it untamed.
Right.
No,
right.
I love the beauty of Avatar, especially now that I've got a Blu-ray player and a 1080 flat screen, but the story is so dull, I don't know if I want to add it to my collection.
Well, so there's one nice innovation, I don't know if it's innovation, but the remote control of an Avatar, right? So that was the whole big point of this. So now it's like a drone, only it's in a human form, and, you know, are we ever really going to get to like a war where not only are there equipment remote controlled, but there's people. So that was a bit of
proxy war?
Proxy war is actually
proxy
war. Very old story. 50s or so, by Colin Cathran. I got it in hardcover someplace else. I can't find it anywhere else. It took me forever to locate it. Called Gottlos. Gottloss, which I guess is German for godless. Okay. And the whole thing is, this is from the 50s, and it's a war with you know, guys duking it out via remote control, you know, drones, the whole virtual reality rigs and stuff. And one of the things is they actually have jamming and bandwidth issues. And Cap is describing this, but those words didn't even exist at that time. But you can see him trying to describe this to an audience for whom these wouldn't even be concepts.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it was handled really, really well. And the protagonist of the story is, you know, a hot shit VR mecha pilot who runs into somebody and gets his ass kicked. Because this guy has, the guy he's facing has impossible reflexes, impossible reaction times. He gets his butt kicked. He ends up working with a bunch of spies who are looking for this guy on the other side, and eventually figure out that in order to get around the reaction time issue with telepresence, the mech Gottlos is a human brain removed from somebody's skull, put in a jar, and installed directly in the mech.
Oh, wow.
I did not make that connection, but you are absolutely right.
That's what I was saying. Everybody borrows each other's concepts.
Oh, sure.
So where's that other one? That movie that just came out where they're, I can't remember the name of it, but you have like five different factions and you have a test.
Divergent.
Divergent, right? So the whole thing, at the end of it, they have this saying, okay, now we'll give you this serum or whatever, and you're going to be remote controlled. I'm sitting there, that doesn't fit at all with the whole rest of the movie.
Yeah, that movie was not good. I don't like it.
Yeah, we were talking about Avatar putting people into a new, like a tank-raised body. They had that in, it was a fairly recent sci-fi movie with Schwarzenegger. Sorry, I can't think of the name, but...
Are you thinking of Surrogates?
What's it
with
called?
Bruce Willis? Bruce Willis.
That's what I was thinking of earlier with Surrogates.
No, they had the assassins attempting to kill the Schwarzenegger character.
Oh, the Eighth Day.
Sixth Day.
Oh,
right,
yeah.
Right. And the bad guys kept getting killed and kept getting re-implanted.
The funniest part of that whole movie was when the one part where the guy gets his leg shot out from under him and says, dang, those are new shoes.
I thought pretty much made the entire point of the movie is a scene where the new guy is popping out of the tank in his new clone body, and his previous him he had just been copied over from is lying on the floor dying, and the new one just walks over and, I need your clothes, and strangles his previous self.
Yeah.
And it's like,
awesome.
Yeah, same person. Copy of? Where is the continuance here?
You can only have one clone at a time. If you have more than one clone active, things get messy.
Yeah.
And it got messy in that scene.
Oh, speaking of guilty pleasure, anyone watching the Orphan Black series on BBC?
You know,
yeah.
I
love that.
I just binge watched all the episodes.
So did I, because my roommate had seen it, and I hadn't, so I had to play catch up.
Anyone's pleasure.
I've heard of it, but what's the
name
of
it? I have to watch Battlefield Earth.
Battlefield Earth.
I couldn't.
See, now I gotta confess.
Sorry.
I thought the book,
and that's what
they're
about.
Love
about the dogs.
I haven't seen the movie,
and
then I saw the movie.
I watched the whole thing.
It was so long-winded, and even after he got rid of the site clothes, there was all the other species that came in.
It's not leaving you guys having a drink. Scientology representatives, you know, try to, what do they call when they use the little device?
What are those called?
E-meters. E-meters. Yeah. I was e-meter to see if I...
What is an e-meter?
You had too much money?
Speaking of Midworld, I would love to see a Dark Tower movie/HBO series.
Yes.
Although the last
thing with a gun
sucked.
Would go so
well. I disagree. I really like
what's that?
My hardest is she really shows up right at the end.
If you didn't like the ending, you should have sat pretty when he told
you.
Yeah.
The guy, well, I don't want to give away the ending to anybody, but.
How about a dead serious
I didn't
reboot
that great.
Of Ghostbusters?
Yep. Wait, dead serious Ghostbusters?
Yes, we have proven technologically that there is an afterlife. We can capture former
humans. Yeah, save you to Pacific Rim. Just Pacific Rim 2. Go-